seen is Sparta. He who's best of art hath drawn this piece, calls it the broken heart.
Many.
Give me one, a good one, such I expect. And now we part must have. Athens, pray why to Athens? You intend not to kick against the world, turn cynic, stoic, or read the logic lecture, or become an aeropagite, and judge in cases touching the commonwealth. But as I take it, the budding of your chin cannot prognosticate some grave and honour.
All this I acknowledge.
You do? Then, son, if books and love of knowledge inflame you to this travel, here in Sparta you may freely study.
Tis not that, madam.
Not that, madam. As a mother, I command thee to acquaint me with the truth.
Thus, I obey you. After so many quarrels and dissension, fury and rage broke to my blood. And sometimes with death such confederates as sided with now dead King Thrasus and yourself, my lady. Our present queen, Amyclas, reconciled your eager swords and sealed a gentle peace. Friends, you protest yourselves. Which to confirm a resolution for a lasting league betwixt our families was entertained. By joining in a hireman and bond, me and the fair Pentheia, only daughter to Thrasus.
What of this?
Much! Much, dear lady. A freedom of converse, an interchange of holy and chaste love. So fixed our souls in the firm growth of union that no time could eat into the pledge. We had enjoyed the sweets of our vows expected, had not cruelly prevented all those triumphs we prepared for by Thrasus' his untimely death.
Most certain.
From this time sprouted up that poison of stalk of aconite, whose ripened roots have ravished all health, all comfort of a happy life for Ithacles, her brother. Proud of youth and prouder of his power, nourished closely the memory of former discontents to glory and revenge by cunningly partly by threats and woos at once, and forces his virtuous sister to win a marriage with Basinus. A nobleman and honour and riches, I confess, beyond my fortunes.
Well, this is no sound reason to importune my leave for thy departure.
Now follows beauteous Pentheia. Wedded to this tortured by an insulting brother, being secretly compelled to yield the virgin freedom up to him who could never usurp our heart, before contracted mine is now so yonked by a barbarous thraldom, miseries, afflictions, that he savours not humanity, whose sorrows mount not into more than pity and hearing but her name.
As how, pray?
Basinus! The man who calls a wife considers truly what heaven of perfection he is lord by thinking fair Pentheia his. His thought begates a kind of monster love, which lovers nurse into a fear so strong and servile as brand all dotage with jealousy. All eyes who gaze upon that shrine of beauty, he doth resolve to do homage to the miracle, someone he is assured may now or then have opportunity to pursue or prevail. So much out of a selfing worthiness, his fears transport him, not that he finds cause in her obedience, but his own mistrust.
Out your discord.
My griefs are violent! this here for a quarter to me. His jealousies grow wild that I should steal again into her favours and undermine her virtues, which the gods know I nor dare nor dream of. Hence, I undertake a voluntary exile. Firstly, by my absence, take off the cares of jealous bastardess. But chiefly, madam, to free Pentheia from a hell on earth. And lastly, to lose the memory of something her presence makes live me in afresh.
Enough, my Orgilus, enough. To Athens, I give full consent. Alas, good lady, we shall hear from thee often.
Often.
See, thy sister comes to give farewell. Brother!
Euphrania! Thus on thy cheeks I print a brother's kiss. More careful of thine honour, thy health, and thy well-doing than my life. Before we part in presence of our mother, I must prepare a suit to you.
You may style it, my brother. A command.
That you will promise never to pass to any man, however worthy your faith, till with our mother's leave I give a free consent.
An easy motion. I'll promise her, Orgilus.
Your pardon, Euphrania's oath must yield me satisfaction.
By Bacchus and sacred fires, I swear it.
And I, by great Apollo's beams, join in the vow, not without thy allowance to bestow her on any living.
Dear Euphrania, mistake me not. Far, far it is from my thought, as far from any wish of mine, to the preference of an honourable bed or fitting fortune. Thou art young and handsome. 'Twere injustice, more a tyranny, not to advance thy merits. Trust me, sister, it should be my first care to see the matters any may become thy choice and our contents. I have your own?
You haven't, but me and your brothers, me as I should say.
Aye, aye, Euphrania. He has just grounds direct him. I will prove a mother and a brother to thee.
Hearts
have nothing. Thy brother will return
in
safety to us.
Souls sunk in sorrows never are without them. They change fresh airs to bear the griefs about them.
Long life, great lady.
It will. It must grow long. Thy bold nephew, death-braving Iphicles, brings to our gates triumphs and peace upon his conquering sword. Laconia is a monarchy at length. Hath in this latter war trod under foot Messene's pride. Messene bows her neck to Lacedaemon's royalty. Oh, 'twas a glorious victory, and doth deserve more than a chronicle. Temple? Lords, a temple to the name of Iphicles.
Where dost thou leave him, Prophilus?
At Pephon, most gracious sovereign. 20 of the nobles of Messenians there attend your pleasure, for such conditions as you shall propose in settling peace and the liberty of life.
When comes your friend, the general?
He promised to follow Thor's speed convenient.
Our daughter, dear Calantha, the conquest of Messene hath already enriched thy knowledge.
With the circumstance around the fight, related faithfully by Prophilus herself. But pray, madam, tell me how doth you for General Tamina's actions in these fortunes?
Excellent princess, your own fair eyes may soon report the truth unto your judgment. With what moderation, calmness of nature, measure bounds and limits of thankfulness and joy. A death digests such amplitude of his success as would in others. Moulded of a spirit less clear, advanced him to comparison with heaven. But Iphicles...
Your friend.
He is so, madam, in which the period of my fate consists. He, in this firmament of honour, stands like a starfix, not moved by any thunder of popular applause, or in sudden lightning of self-opinion. He has served for his country, and thinks it was but his duty.
You describe a miracle of man.
Such, Crotalon, on forfeit of a queen's word, thou wilt find him.
Hark! Warning of his coming! All attend him!
Madam, you are lost to partial.
Our country speaks by me, who by thy below wisdom and service shares in this great action, returning thee, imparted thy due merits, a general welcome.
You exceed in bounty.
If it please. Upon the wings of fame, the singular and chosen fortune of a high attempt has borne surpassed a few common sight, that I myself and mine hands have wrought to crown my temples. This provincial garland, accept, wear, and enjoy it as our gift deserved, not purchased.
You're a royal maid.
She isn't all, our daughter.
Let me blush, acknowledging how poorly I have served. But nothing's I've done compared to the honest teeth on the issue of a willing mind, in that lady mind ability. But who is he, so sluggish from birth, so little worthy of name or country, and it owes a lot of gratitude like in death of service, or does so ever safety the Commonwealth Council requires payment?
It speaks truth.
Through heaven is pleased to Salvatorians. Such a portion is madden. Like the drunken priest and Bacchus sacrifices without reason, voicing on the lead of a demigod. Whereas each common soldier's blood drops down the current coin of that hard purchase, whose much more delicate condition has sucked the milk of bees. Judgment! Command! With resolution executes, I use not in front of this royal presence. These fit slights, as in contempt, as can direct. My speech hath other end, not to attribute all praise to one man's fortune, which was strengthened by many hands.
Courtiers turned soldiers, we vouchsafe our hand. Observe your great example.
With all diligence, obsequiously and hourly,
some repose is needful after these toils. We must think on conditions for the conquered. Be expectant. Come, my other please.
Madam, with your favour, I need not a supporter. Fate instructs me.
Spirit of valour is of a mounting nature. Pray, in earnest, how many men apiece have you been the death of? In faith, not many. We were composed of mercy. For our daring, you heard the general's approbation before the queen. You wished your country's peace. That showed your charity. Where are your spoils, such as the soldier fights for? When I was in the thickest of mine enemies, slashing off one man's nose, another's head, another's arms and legs, and all together, then I would with a sigh remember thee and cry, dear lady, it is for thy sake I do these deeds of wonder. Dost thou not love me with all thy heart now? Hang him! Let us scorn them! And be revenged!
Tempt not the stars, O brother! Thou canst not play
severity of fate. This change of habit and disguise and outward view has not the secrets from thy soul from within thee, their quick piercing eyes, which dive at all times down to thy thoughts and in thy aspect. I am not a consequence of danger.
Give me leave, great Telemachus. Thou foredooming destiny under thy roof to ease my silent griefs by applying to my hidden wounds the balm of thy oracular lectures. If my fortune runs such a crooked byway as to rest my steps to ruins, yet thy learned steps shall call me back and set my footing straight. You're not caught the world.
Ah, Autolus, neglecting young men of delights and run often to extremities. They care not to harm those who contend their own.
But I, most learned artist, am not so much with odd nature that I grudge the fifth of any true deserver, nor doth malice of present hope so check them with despair as that I yield to more thoughts than what is incident to frailty. Wherefore not impute this retired course of living some little time to any other cause than what I justly render, the information of an unsettled mind, as the effects may clearly witness.
Spirit of truth, inspire thee! Oh! On these conditions, I conceal thy change, and willingly admit thee to an auditor.
Aye, to contemplations in these delightful walks. Thus, metamorphosed, and may without suspicion hearken after Pentheus' usage, and Euphranius' faith, love, thou art full of mystery. The deities themselves are not secure in searching out the secrets of those flames, which, hidden, were suppressed may attribute to the laws of beauty. This is yet to never found the remedy to cure a lover's wound.
Ha! Who are those who cross your private walks into the shadowing groves and armorous foldings?
My sister. Oh, my sister. It is Euphrania, with Prophilus. Supported, too. I would have an admiration. Prophilus, she is Iphicles' friend. It's strange, it puzzles me. Again, my books. The scholar's habit shall stand my privilege. My mind is busy. Mine eyes and ears are open.
Do not waste the span of stolen time lent by the gods of precious youth. In niceness. Brother Phrenia, should I repeat old vows? Or study new? To purchase the belief of my desires?
Desires?
My service, my integrity?
That's better.
I should but repeat a lesson often conned, without a prompter but thine eyes. My love is honourable.
So is mine to Pentheus, chastely honourable.
Nor wants the more addition to my wish of happiness than having thee a wife. Already shall Iphicles, friend firm and unalterable.
But a brother more cruel than the grave.
What can you look for in answer to your noble protestations, but an unskillful maid? Suited to a language of a divided mind.
Hold out, Euphrania.
No, Prophilus, I never divide the first time you mentioned worthy love, your merit, means, or person. It had been a fault of judgment in me and a dullness of my affections, not to weigh and reflect my better stars to offer me the grace of so much blissfulness. For to speak truth of my lord-kept desires at equal pace with yours, nor have I left that resolution, but only in a word, every choice lives nearest in my heart must first procure consent from both my mother and my brother. Here, he opened his.
She has forsworn else.
Leave me their task. My brother parted to Athens and had my oath.
Yes, yes, I had, sure.
Doubt not. What the means a court supplies were to prevail at pleasure.
Very likely.
Meantime, best, dearest, I may build my hopes on the foundation of thy constant sufferance in any opposition.
not sooner divorce the joys and life I have living in my chaste vows from truth.
On thy fair hand, I'll seal the life.
There is no faith in woman. Passion no be contained. My very heartstrings are the tantas!
Madam! We are overhead. Cupid protects us to a staring, madam, of someone near.
Your fears are needless, lady. None have access into these private pleasures, except some nearing court, or bosom shown from Technicus his oratory, granted by special favour from the queen and to the great philosopher.
Methinks I hear one talking to himself. I see him.
It is a poor scholar, as I told you, lady.
I am discovered. Say, is it possible with a smooth tongue and laughing countenance, luckily or force of reason, I come ye, sir, to turn or to obey his raging sea? Answer to that. You are to catch at the hold fast and let the sun swell that tones. No, they're out. The mares in the run a cloud driven by a northern dastard's fiddle faggle, so peace off speak sense.
Call you this single scholar? Alas, he is a lunatic.
Observe him! Sweet. It is but his recreation.
I would mean to hear anything! You're so dead cheap. You give no hold in argument. Philosophy works not upon the possibilities, but natural conclusions. New! Absurd! The metaphysics are but speculations of a celestial body, or such accents as do not mix perfectly in the air engendered appear also natural. After all, prove it. Yet, with reverence to your gravity, I'll balk a little resourcefulness in meeting my solid opinion to the touch of letters.
Now, let us fall with him.
These elfish boys, when they but taste the gravities and principles of theory, imagine they can oppose their teachers. Confidants, these many into errors.
By your leave, sir.
Are you a scholar, friend?
I am, gay creature. With pardon of your deities, a mushroom whom the jewel of heaven drops now and then. The sun shines on me too, I thank his beams, and sometimes feel their warmth and eat and sleep.
Does Technicus read to thee?
Yes, forsooth, he is my master, surely. Yonder door opens upon his study.
Happy creatures. Such people turn not, sweet, in heats of state, nor sinking thoughts of greatness. Their affections keep order to their modesty. Their love is of a virtue. What's thy name?
Aplotis! Sumptuous mistress. A poor wretch.
Lady, dost thou want anything?
Books. Avena's books.
A new fancy comes in my thoughts, and most available for both our comforts.
My lady,
whilst I endeavour to deserve your mother's blessings to our loves, this scholar may daily, at certain hours, attend what notice I can write of my success. Here in this grove, and give it to your hand, and from the like from you to me, so that we can never bard of our mutual speech. One sure intelligence, thus our hearts can talk while our tongues cannot.
Occasion most favorable, use it.
Appletees, wilt thou wait on us twice a day?
Yeah.
At 9 in the morning and 4 at night?
Yeah.
Here in this bower? To convey such letters as each shall send to other? Willingly, safely, and secretly, and I will furnish thy study, or what else I canst desire.
Go! Make me thankful, I beseech thee, proprietor Jove. I will prove sure and trusty. You will not fail me, books.
Nor aught besides thy heart can wish. This lady's name's Euphrania. Mine, Prophilus.
I have a pretty memory. It must prove my best friend. I will not miss 1 minute of Alvarez appointed.
Write the books that would have bought thee a note, or take thyself some money.
No. Money to scholars is a spirit invisible. We dare not finger it, or books are nothing.
Books of what sort thou wilt?
Do
not forget our names.
Warrant ye.
Smile, Hymen, on the growth of our desires. We feed thy tortures with
eternal fires.
Put out my torches, Simon, with a light from me the darkness of eternal night. Inspiring Mercury of swift deceits, genius fate that leapt into my arms beyond the compass of my brain. Mortality creeps upon the dung of earth, who cannot reach the riddle's purpose by the gods. Great arts best write themselves in their own stories. They die too basely to outlive their glories.
There's a lust committed by the eye that sweats and travails, plots, wakes, contrives, till a deformed bear whelp, adultery, be licked into the act, the very act. That light shall be damned up too. Do you hear, sir?
I do hear, my lord. A mason shall be provided suddenly.
Some rogue of your confederacy, factor for slaves and strumpets, to convey close package with this spruce springle, and t'other youngster, that gaudy earwig. Oh, my lord, your patron, whose pensioner you are. Ah! I'll tear thy throat up, son of a cat! Ill-looking hound's head, rip up thy ulcerous moor if I but send a paper. A scroll, as hard as figures what can cover up a wart on my nose, a spot, a paper directed to my lady! May prove a mystical preparative to lewdness.
Care shall be had. I will turn every third apartment to an eye. Here's a sweet light.
City housewives cunning in the traffic of chamber merchandise at all a price by wholesale. Yet, they wipe their mouths and simper, cull, kiss and cry, sweetheart, and stroke the hedge which they have branched.
And all is well again.
Dark clods of dirt who do not feel the rough stop on their foreheads.
Tis a villainous world. One cannot hold his own in it.
Dames at court who flaunt and riot on another bias. Their pleasure heaves the patient ass that suffers upon the stilts of office. Titles, incomes, promotion justifies the shame and sues for it. Poor honor, thou art stabbed and grievest to death by such unlawful hire. The country mistress is yet more weary, and in her blushes, hard to ever trespass, cause her thought the guilt. But all false. On this truth I am bold. No woman but can fall, or doth, or would. Now, the newest news about the city. What blab the voices, sirrah?
Strangers, tickling.
Hey! Up and ride, you rascal! What is it?
Forsooth, they say the queen has new.
Ignorant block.
Yes, Tula, and it's talked about the streets, and since, Lord, if the queens came home, the lions are never left roaring, a witch noise of birds and ducks in every heart, so.
Dance out thine, too.
Besides, Lord Orgilus is fled to Athens. Upon a fiery dragon, and it is thought he never can return.
Granted, Apollo.
Moreover, please, your lordship, to support it for certain that whoever is found jealous without the power improved, the twice wanton shall be divorced. But this is what she news. I heard it from a midwife. I am lawyer.
Antic no more. Idiots! And stupid fools great my calamities. Why, to be fair, should yield presumption of a faulty soul? Look to the doors!
The Horn of Plenty, crest him.
Swarms of confusion huddle in my thoughts and rear his temper. Beauty. Oh, it is an unmatched blessing. Or a horrid curse.
She comes! She comes!
Oh, so shoots the morning forth, spangled with pearls of transparent dew. The way to poverty is to be rich as I am in her wealthy, but for her, in all contents, a bankrupt.
Loved Pentheia, how fares my heart's best joy?
In sooth, not well. She's so oversat.
Leave, chattering magpie!
Thy brother has returned, sweet, safe, and honored with a triumphant victory. Thou shalt visit him. We will to court where, if it be thy pleasure, thou shalt appear in such a ravishing lustre of jewels above value, that the dames who brave it there, enraged to be outshined, shall unseen hide in their closets and fret in their tears, whilst every wandering eye shall crave none other brightness but thy presence. Choose thine own recreations. Be a queen of what delights thou fanciest best. What place, what times. Do anything. Do all the things that youth can command. So thou wilt chase the clouds from the pure firmament of thy fair look.
Now tis lost, Avalon! Well, Lena, laugh, be merry, time is precious.
Fury's with me!
Hush, my lord! This language to your handmaid sounds as would music to the deaf. I need no braveries, no cost of art to draw the whiteness from my name into offense. Let such, if any such there are, who could better curiosity of admiration by laying out their plenty in full view, appear in gaudy outsets. My attire shall suit the outward fashion of my mind, from which, with your opinion, change not the livery your words bestow. My fortunes and my hopes are the highest.
This house, methinks, stands somewhat too much inward. It is too melancholy. We'll remove nearer the court. What thinks my Pentheia of this delightful island we command? Rule me as thou canst wish.
I am no mistress. If you please, I must attend. Always your light pleasant to me.
Island! Prison! Our prisoners again, sir. We are no islands, Mara.
Grouses, you are a juggling dwarf. This sadness, sweet, has become my youthful blood. I'll have you pounded. For my sake, put on more cheerful mar. I'll mar thy cheeks and make me old in griefs. Damn of a bitch fox.
I am fit of hearing still. When the wind blows to the left, what think ye? If you are freshly, you breed your bones. My lad, would not a chopping boy do good at heart? But, as you said,
speak your mistake or chop these colours.
Pray, speak louder, sharp, sharp, the wind blows so still.
Thou pratest madly.
Tis very hot. I sweat extremely.
Now?
Lord! Ladies!
Where?
Horses!
Peasant, how?
Carriages and drifts. The one enter, the other one leave without, sir. And now, I vanish.
Noble bestness?
Most welcome, Propolis. To you my heart is open. You honor me.
Oh, my
swells in my head already. Honor me bountifully.
How they flutter, white tail and jays together.
From your brethren, by virtue of your letter to him, I require in some presents, fairest.
Here's well, madam.
The gods preserve him ever. Yet, dear beauty, I found to ration him ever since you returned to Sparta. My good lord, use no delay.
We had not needed an invitation. If a sister's health had not fallen into question, haste, Pentheus, lack not a minute. Lead the way, good Propolis. I'll follow step by step.
You are, madam?
One word with your old borscht. Thou spent away from the sins thou worshipped and abhorred my will. I'll use thee cursedly.
You go! You are beside yourself! A politician in jealousy! No, you're too gross, too vulgar, pish! Teach me not my trade! I know my cue! My cross and you sink me into a trust, by which I shall know all. My trade shall I!
Forgive me, Crassus! 'Twas consideration I relish not! But have a care now!
Fear not! I know new come to it!
Thy life's upon it! And so is mine. My agonies are infinite.
Ambition. It is a viper's breed. In order to pass through the wound that gave emotion. Ambition. I can see a dove. It mounts upwards. Pirate higher still. Perched by the craft and must head on down the heavier route. Squibs and crackers fly into the air. Then, only breaking with a noise, they vanish in stench and smoke. Morality plies its time of practice, keeps its soul in tune, at whose all thou sweet music dance. This is just a form of books and school traditions. If physics not a sickness of a mind broken with griefs, strong fevers are not ease to counsel, but the better seek the means of feeding means uncertain. That's the cure!
Propolis is every way deceitful. I am confident my wisdom is too right to need instruction from my son's tutelage, yet not a right that it dares to dote upon the painted beat of smooth persuasion, which tempts me to a breach of faith.
Not yet resolved, my lady. Your son's consent to be so available. He will write to Athens for his return to Sparta. The Queen's hand will join us our desires. She's been moved to it.
Yes, the Queen herself importuned myself for a dispatch. Queens may command, their wills are laws not to be questioned.
And by this marriage, you knit a union since you vote, so heartily, between your love for mine and mine for yours, the man who both has an interest in it, for Prophets is mine, and I am hers.
My lord?
What could the lady speak your thought?
Had this sincerity been real once, my orgulous had not been now unwived, nor your lost sister buried in a bride bed. Your aunt here knows this truth, but had your father Thrasus lived. But priest still on his grave. I have done, I am bold and bitter.
Oppresses home the injury. It smarts. No reprehensions, and I deserve him. Yet, gentle lady, consider what an unsteady youth. A giddy brain. Green indiscretion, philatery of greatness, rawness and judgment, wealthiness and folly. Fourth favourite in the wind might be the boy in ears. It was a fault, a capital fault. I could dive to the realm of commanding love, when I find experience by the extremes of others. And fourthly correct. Trust me, Crotalon, I would deem those wrongs in any way your satisfaction can revive the courage.
The acknowledgement of satisfaction, what would you more? I'm conquered. If Euphrania herself amid the motion, let it be so. I doubt not my son's liking.
Use my fortunes, life, power, sword, and heart. All for your own.
Princess.
in her company.
Your gracious princess. Sister. Well, not cold to serve the passion in your nature, but to impose all duty to your husband, not even so attendant on a dear mistress. It is not my brother's pleasure, I presume it, to immure her in a chamber.
Tis her will. She governs her own hours. Noble Ithocles, we thank the gods for your success and welfare. Our lady has of late been indisposed, else we had waited on you with the first.
How does Pentheia now?
Best new brother, from whom my health and comforts are derived.
I like this answer well. It is sad and modest. And maybe tricks yet. Tricks. Have an eye, Grouchus.
Now, Corotalon, you should be joined and must not fall by Tanakimo.
It is granted, Princess, for my part, with condition that my son favor the contract.
Such delay is easy! The joys of marriage make thee, Propolis, a part of Euphrania's love, and her thanks there.
The joys of marriage are heaven on earth. Life's paradise, great princess. The soul's quiet. Sinews of concord. Earthly immortality. Eternity of pleasures. No restoratives like to a constant woman. But where is she? Could puzzle all the gods but to create such a new monster. I can speak by proof, for I rest in Elysium. Tis my happiness.
Freya, how you resolve to speak freely in your affections to this gentle woman?
No more nor less than Helen shows me, which, with your liking to my brother's words, I cannot but approve of one point worthy.
So, I know your answer.
It'd be a pity. Sunder hearts so we can be consented.
The Queen! Lord Ithocles. Commands your presence. And the fairest princess yours.
We will attend her.
Where are the lords? Almost until the Queen without delay. Prince of Argos.
Well, sir.
It is coming to the court, sweet lady.
How? The Prince of Argos?
It was my fortune, madam, to enjoy the honour of these happy tidings.
Pentheia?
Brother?
I recommend our hence reaching the palace forever alone. I have some secret with you. Privy friend. Conduct her thither. Have special care the walks if any to disturb us.
I shall.
How's that?
Alone! Pray be alone! Die! I'm your creature, princess. On, my lords!
Alone? Alone? What means that word alone? And why am I not either? He's a brother. Brothers and sisters of the flesh and blood. And this same whore son is caused ease to a temptation in the veins. Besides, his fine friend, Prophilus, must be her guardian. Why may not he dispatch a business nimbly before the other come? Or pandering, pandering for one another. Be it sister, wife, mother, cousin, anything. Among youths and men requested is so. Oh, stubborn fate! If I can be a cuckold and can know it, I will be fell. And fell.
My lord, you're called for.
Most heartily, I thank you. Where's my wife, pray?
Retired amongst the ladies.
Still, I thank you. There's an old waiter with her. Saw you her, too?
She sits in the presence lobby, fast asleep, sir.
Asleep! Asleep, sir!
Is your lordship troubled? You will not to the queen?
Your humblest vassal.
Your servant, my good lord.
I await your footsteps.
In the swamp, lady, will your brother find you? With your favour, give me leave a little to work a preparation. In his fashion, I've observed of late some kind of slackness, such alacrity as nature once accustomed took delight in. Sadness grows upon his recreations, which he holds in such a willing silence. That's your question. The grounds will argue little skill in friendship and less good manners.
Madam, I am not inquisitive of secrecies without an invitation.
With pardon, lady, not a syllable of mine implies so rude a sense. The drip. Do thy best to make this Lady Mary for an hour.
Your will shall be a law, madame.
Leave me! I have some private thoughts I ought to account with. Use thou thine own.
Speak on, fair nymph. Our souls can dance as well to the music of the spheres as any to our sister with the gods.
Your school terms are too troublesome.
What heaven refines mortality from joss of earth? But such as unconfounded beauty hollows or glorified perfections?
Set thy wits in a less wild proportion.
Time can never on the white table of unguilded fate my contributed summers. Turn those eyes, the apples of pure love, and once rose to a flame, perfectly scented incense, smoking vessels, altars, the holiest altars, virgin's tears. Sprinkle enough juice to feed them and increase their further.
Be not frantic!
Your pleasures are but mere imagination. Feeding the hungry appetite with steam and sight of banquets, whilst the body pines not relishing the real taste of food. Such is the leanness of a heart divided from intercourse of chuff contracted love. No harsh should efface our precious figures here, the lively stamp of equal souls.
Away! Some fear I have bewitched thy tongue! The breath of ignorance that flies from thence ripens in me a knowledge of afflictions above all suffering. Things of talk, be gone without reply.
Be just, Pentheia, in thy commands, and thou send forth a doom of punishment. No first on whom it lights. Thus, I take off the shroud in which my cares have been folded up from the view of common eyes. What is thy sentence next? Rather examine me, how I could live to say I've been much, much wronged. 'Tis for thy sake I put on this imposture. Dear Pentheia, if thy soft bosom not be turned to marble, thou pity our calamities, my interest confirms, thou art mine still.
Lend your hand. here before ye.
You instruct my duty.
We may stand up. Have you aught else to urge from your demand? As for the old, forget it. It is buried in an everlasting silence, and shall be ever. What more would ye?
I will possess my wife. The equity of very reason bids me.
Is that all?
Why, it's all of me myself.
Remove your steps some distance from me. At this space, a few words I dare change. But first, put on your borrowed shape.
You are obeyed.
How orderless. I promise I was there, and the heavens do witness. They can witness too, a rape done on my truth. How I do love thee yet, orderless, and yet must best appear in tendering thy freedom, for I found the constant preservation of thy merit. By thy not daring to attempt my fame of any injury of loose conceits, which might give deeper wounds to discontent. Continue this fair race then, for though I cannot add to thy comfort, I shall more often remember from what fortune I am fallen and pity mine own ruin. Live! Live happy! Happy in thy next choice that thou mayest people in this barren age of virtues in thy issue. I know when thou art married, think of me with mercy, not contempt. I hope thy wife, hearing my story, will not scorn my fault. Thou let us part.
Part! Yet advise thee better. Better his wife to orderless than ever shall be.
Never shall nor will.
How?
Hear me. In a word, I'll tell thee why. The virgin dowry, which my birth bestowed, is ravished by another. My true love abhors to me that orderless deserve no better favours than a second bet.
I must not take this reason. Pentheia, now I tell you, you go once in my sovereign. Come, sweet, thou art mine! Resolved to do. Actions, not words, shall show me.
Sad, my name, sure as he parted from me. I fear I was too rough. Poor man's look, not like the ruins of his youth, but like the ruins of those ruins. Honor, how we fight with weakness to preserve thee.
Fie on thee! Damn thee, rotten maggot, damn thee! Asleep! Asleep at court! And now, aches, convulsions, impostumes, wounds, gouts, palsies. Clog thy bones a dozen more years yet.
Now we are in humours.
She's by herself, there's hope of that. She's sad too. She's in strong contemplation, yes, and fixed. The signs are wholesome.
Very wholesome, truly.
Hold your chops, nightmare! Lady, come! Your brother is carried to his closet. We must thither.
Not well, my lord.
There's something fit. Twill off. Some servant or disorder. How dost, Eurus?
Your news is not at best.
<clears throat>
chief of men, the excellences, Iphicles, desires your presence, madam.
We are hasting to him.
In vain we labor in this course of life to piece our journey out at length. We'll crave his plighted breath. Our home is in the grave.
Perfect philosophy.
Let us care to live so, so that our reckonings may fall even when we're to make account.
He cannot fear who pulls on noble grounds. Sickness or pain is a deserver's exercise, and such your virtuous brother to the world is known. Speak comfort to him, lady. Be all gentle. Stars fall but in the grossness of our sight. The good men dying, the earth doth lose her light.
Resolution of giddy rashness choked the breath of reason.
It shall not, most sage master.
I am jealous. For if the borrowed shapes were able to uninferred consequence, we must conclude some violent design of sudden nature to have shook the shadow off, to fly upon a new hatched execution. Orgerus, take heed thou hast not, under our integrity, shrewded unlawful plots. Our mortal lives have not pierced the secrets of your heart. God's only privy to them.
Learned Technicus, such doubts are causeless, and to clear the truth from misconceit, the present state commands me. The Prince of Argos comes himself in person in quest of great Calantha for his bride, our kingdom's heir. Besides, mine only sister Euthrania is disposed to Prophilus. And lastly, the Queen is sending letters to Athens, my quick repair to court. Please to accept these reasons.
Just once, Orgilus, not to be contradicted, yet beware of an unsure foundation. For no fair colours can fortify a building faintly jointed. Now, I have observed a growth in thy aspect of dangerous extent. Sudden, and look to it, I might add certain.
My aspect? Could I run through mine inmost thoughts? It should not sit an inclination there more than what's suited with justice and mine honour.
I believe it. But know then, Orgilus, what honour is. Honour consists not in a bare opinion by doing any act that feeds content. Brave in appearance, because we think it brave. Such honour comes by accident, proceeding from the vices of our passion, which make our reason drunk. Real honour is the reward of virtue, and is acquired by justice, or by the law which forbids us have justice to uphold it. He then fails in honour, who for lucre or revenge commits. Thefts, murders, treasons, and adulteries. With such like, by entrenching unjust laws, see how honour must be grounded on knowledge, not opinion. For opinion relies on probability and accident, knowledge of necessity and truth. I leave thee to the fit consideration of what becomes this the grace of real honour, wishing success to all thy virtuous meanings.
The gods increase thy wisdom, Reverend Oracle. And in thy precepts make me ever thrifty.
I thank thy wish. The mystery of fate lies hidden in that man's fortunes. Curiosity may lead his actions into rare attempts. Let the gods be moderate still. No human power can prevent their will. Whence come ye?
Queen Amyclas, pardon my interruption of your studies. Here in this sealed box she sends a treasure to you dear to her as her crown. Appraise your gravity. You would examine the pith and circumstance of every title the scroll within contains.
What is it, Crotalon?
It is the Queen's life, the health of Sparta, sinews and safety of the Commonwealth, the sum of what the Oracle delivered when last she visited the prophetic temple at Delphos, what her reasons are for which, after so long a silence, she requires your counsel now, grave man. Her Majesty will soon herself acquaint with you. special cause the Queen importunes you for resolution of the Oracle.
My duty to the Queen, good peace to Sparta, and fair day to Crotalon.
Like to Tacticus.
Who's there? Sister? Walk with the room, Alice.
It is consented!
Lord Bassinus, your brother would be private. We must forbear. His sleep hath newly left him. Please, you withdraw.
By any means, it is fit.
Pray, gentlewoman.
Walk to him!
Yes, I will, madam.
Nearer, sister to me, nearer yet. We had one father, from one womb gave life. We brought up twins together, but to live a distance like two strangers. For I could have wished that the first pillow when I was cradled had proved me to be
grave. You had been happy. Had you never known that sin of life, the plots or the falling glories of a vengeance, but forfeiting the last will of the dead, from whom you had your being.
Sad Pentheus, thou can't be too cruel. My rash blade hath a violent hand, plucked from thy bosom of a blessed heart, grindeth into dust, for mine, it is now a breaking.
Not yet, heaven. I do beseech thee. But first, let some wildfire scorch, not consume it. May the heat be cherished with desires infinite, but hopes impossible.
Wrong soul. Thy prayers are heard.
Here, lo, I breathe. A miserable creature, led to ruin by an unnatural brother.
I consume all ancient affection to that trespass. Yet cannot die.
The handmaid to the wages of country toil drinks the untroubled streams, with the leaping kids and the bleating lambs. And so allays her fear secure, whilst I quench my hot sighs with the bleatings of my tears.
The labourer doth eat his course of bread, earned by his sweat, and then lies him down to sleep. Yet I beguile such turn to digestion, as gouts Pentheus' curse. Put me to any penance for thy tyranny, and I'll call thee merciful.
Pray! Kill me! Rid me from my thing of a jealous husband. We have joined a friendship, he again, brother and sister.
how does the Lord esteem me?
Only one is such as you have made me. A faith breaker. A spotted hawk. Forgive me, I am one in Agnot's desires. The gods must witness.
Thou dost belie thy friend.
I do not, if it please. For she that wives the orderless and lives in known adultery with bastards is at best a whore. Will kill me now. The ashes of her parents will assume some dreadful figure and appear to charge thy bloody guilt. Thou hast betrayed their name to infamy in this reproachful match.
After my victories abroad, to whom I meet despair, ingratitude of nature hath made my actions monstrous. Thou shalt stand in deity, thy sister, and be worshipped for thy martyrdom. Wrong maids and married wives to thy hallowed shrine shall offer their orients and sacrifice pure turtles crowned with myrtle. It is a pity, for a yielding brother's pressure lend one finger but to reason.
Oh, no more!
And death waits to waft me to the Stygian banks to free me from the curse of thy bondage. Until thou shalt forgive, I must endure.
Who is this saint you serve?
In friendship or nearest to birth, any but that sister. Dares not move that question to me. It is a secret, sister. I do not murmur to myself.
Let me, by your new protestations, I conjure ye, partake her name.
Her name? It is... I dare not.
Oh, your respects are forged.
They are not! Peace, Calamphorus! Princess, the queen's daughter, sole heir to Sparta. Me most miserable now do I love thee. Thy injuries revenge thyself of bravery, and gossips thy treason to the queen's ears. Calamphor knows not yet, nor profitless reign nearest.
Suppose you were contracted to her. Would it not split even your very soul to see her mother snatch her out of your arms and force her on the Prince of Argos?
Trouble not the fountains of mine own eyes. With thine own story, I sweat and blood for it.
We are reconciled. Alas, being but children of two branches of one stock, it is not fit we should divide. Have comfort, you may find it.
Yes, in thee. Only in thee, Pentheia mine.
Sorrows have not too much dulled my infected brain. I'll to your invention for an act of strain.
Madman, why have I wronged a maid so excellent?
I can forbear no longer, more I will not. Keep off your hands or fall upon my points. Patience is tired, but like a slow-paced ass you ride my sloth to easy nature. To vengeance, a reproach, and property!
The meaning of this rudeness?
Sweet lady, come not near him. He holds his perilous weapon in his hand to pick a curse. Now who now her? See?
My birth was noble, though the popular blast of vanity as thy giddy youth has risen thy name up to bestride a cloud or progress a chariot in the sun. I am no clod of trade to lackey pride, nor, like your slave of expectation, wait the bawdy hinges at your doors or whistle for mystical conveyance to your bedsports.
Fine humours. They become him. How a stares, struts, puffs, and sweats. Most admirable lunacy.
May I conceive that while I took possession I sober accustomed, and made thee unmannerly?
You, brother!
Unmannerly? Mew, kittling! Smooth formality is ushered to rankness in the blood, but impudence bears up the train. Indeed, sir, your fiery mettle, or spring of a blaze of huge renown, is no sufficient royalty to print upon my forehead the corn of Skookold.
The jealousy's robbed him of his wit. A noser talks what?
Ah, yes, and the noser whom I talks, drawn of Francis' lust, in swine security, and bestial incest.
Ha, devil!
I will halloo it! Though I blush more to name the filthiness than thou to act it!
Monster!
Serve our friendship!
By our bloods! Will you quite both undo us, brother?
Out on him! These are his megrims, rogues, and melancholies!
Well settled, Torchol. Kick him out of doors!
With favour, let me speak! My lord, what slackness in my obedience have deserved this rage? Except humility and silent duty that have drawn on your unquiet. My simplicity never studied your vexation.
Blight of beauty, deal not urgently with a desperate wound. No breach of reason dares make war with her whose looks are sovereignty, whose breath is balm. Oh, that I could preserve the fruition as in devotion.
Sir, may every evil locked in Pandora's box shower in your presence on my unhappy head. If, since you made me a part in your bed, I've been faulty and one unseemingly fought against your honor.
Purge not his grief, Pentheia.
Yes, say on, excellent creature. Good, be not a hindrance to peace and praise of virtue. My senses are charmed with sound celestial. On, dear, on. I never gave you one ill word, say, did I? Indeed, I did not.
Nor by Juno's forehead was I ever guilty of a wanton error.
The goddess, let me kneel.
Alas, kind animal.
No, but for penance.
Noble sir, what is it? With gladness I embrace it, yet pray let not my rashness teach you to be too unmerciful.
When I shall see good proof of that manly wisdom, not to be overswayed by passion or opinion, to show leadership in your judgment, then this lady, your wife, my sister, shall return to a safety home to be guided by you. But, can I see evidence to prove it? She shall remain in my care.
Rip up my bosom. I'll stand the execution with a constancy. This torture is unsufferable.
Well, sir, I dare not trust it to your fury.
But Pentheia says not so.
She needs no tongue to build excuse to those who never propose wrong.
Virgin of reverence and antiquity, stay you behind. The court wants not your diligence.
What will you do, my lord? My lady's gone. I am denied to follow.
I may see her or speak to her once more.
I feel too, man. Be of good cheer. She's your own flesh and bone.
Disease as desperate must find cures alike. She swore she has been true.
True? On my modest death?
Let him want truth who credits not her vows. Much wrong I did her, but her brother, infinite. Room of a voice with the contempt of man, which is ironimous. Some way I must try to outdo art and jealousy to cry.
Singular perfections, caught to all ears by what I find was published by constant truth, from which, if any service might deserve, can purchase fair construction. This the lady must command it.
Princely, sir, so well you know how to profess observance, that you instruct your hearers to become practitioners in duty. of which number? I'll study to be chief.
Chief, glorious virgin, in my devotions, as in all men's wonders.
Excellent, cousin. We deny no liberty. Use thine own opportunities. Close on. We must consult the philosophers. The business is afoot.
My your pleasure.
You told me, Crotalon, your son's returned from Athens. What for comes he not to court to be commanded?
He shall soon attend your royal will, great lady.
The marriage between our prophets and Euphrates takes too much delay.
My lady,
some pleasures at celebration of your obliged entertainment of the prince are kinsmen. Our court wears gravity more than we relish.
Yet the heavens smile on all your high attempts without a cloud. So may the gods protect us.
The prince is subject?
Yes. Beauty's sceptred, as all hearts kneel. So am I.
You are too courtly.
Your safe return to Sparta is most welcome. I joy to meet you here. And on occasion, I will grant you privacy. I will yield you reasons why I deserve to covet the title of respect and friend. Believe it, Orgulus. This is my ambition.
Your lord should make man me, your poor servant.
So I'm at a close. So soon, my heart.
What sudden changes next?
Life to the queen!
Life to the queen!
To whom here I present this noble gentleman, you come from Athens, royal lady, vouchsafe your gracious hand in favour of his merit.
My son preferred by Empedocles.
Our bounty shall open to thee. Orgulus, for instance, hearken thine ear. If out of those inventions in which flow in Athens, thou hast there engrossed some rarity of wit to grace the nuptials of thy first sister, and renown our court in the eyes of this young prince, we shall be debtor to thy conceit. Think on it.
Your Highness honors me.
My tongue and heart are twins.
A noble birth could make such a father with... just my guest most wishful.
May my duty still rise in your opinion, sacred princess.
Euphrates, brother, sir. A gentleman well worthy of your knowledge.
We embrace him, proud of so dear acquaintance.
she hath. Were Lord her plea against the power of greatness, not the reason, haply such undershrubs as subjects might borrow they to justice, to inform their lies and song tales without check over a meek obedience.
How resolve you touching your sister's marriage? Prophylus is a deserving and hopeful youth.
I envy not her merit for applauding. Can wish her the thrifts of all her best desires, and with a willingness in league our blood with hers, for a purchase of full growth in friendship. She never touched in any wrong the malice of our house, nor stirred our peace. Yet with your favour, let me not forget under whose wings she gathers warmth and comfort, whose creature she is bound, made, and must live so.
Son, I find in thee a harsh condition. No care, seek and win it. It is too rancorous.
Dear lady, be not severe in your constructions. I am no stranger to such easy calms as to sit in tender bosoms. Lordly Ithacles hath graced my entertainment in abundance. Too humbly I've descended from the height of arrogance and spleen which wrought the rape on grief Pentheus' purity. His scorn my untoward fortunes is claimed unto a courtship, almost to a fawning, but I'll kiss his foot. Since you will have it so.
Since I will have it so, friend, I will have it so. Without harbor of my opposing blood, will the maiden smiling in your breast, you have a spirit set, have eager familiar the voice in the air of your intelligence. Sons that have not the glory of humanity, then you come and send them.
It were welcome. I might have found the grave there.
Sure. Your business was soon dispatched, or your mind altered quickly.
Twas care, madam, of health would short my journey. But there is general infection, rents, and desolation!
And I fear thou hast brought back a worse infection with thee. Infection of my mind, which, as thou sayest, threatens the desolation of our family.
Forbid it! Ah, dear genius, I would rather be made a sacrifice on Thrasus' monument, or kneel to Ithacles' son in dust, than woos a mother's curse. My sister's marriage promise is from my heart confirmed. May I live hated, may I die despised, if I omit to further it in all that can concern me.
I have been too rough. My duty to my queen may be so earnest, excuse an orgulous.
Dear lady.
Here comes Euphrania with prophets.
Most honored! Ever famous!
Your true friend, on earth not any truer, with smooth eyes upon this worthy couple, your consent can only make them one.
They have it! Sister, thou pawest to me an oath of which engagement I never will release thee, if thou aims at any other choice than this.
Dear brother, hair or none,
to which are my blessings added?
Which? To the greatest ceremony perfect! Euphrania, lend thy hand. Here, take a prophylus. Live long, a happy wife and wife. And if these in presence may conclude an omen, thus for a bridal song I close my wishes. Comforts lasting, loves increasing, like soft hours never ceasing, plenty's pleasures. Peace complying, without jaws or tongues and vine, hearts by holy union wedded, more than theirs by customs bedded, fruitful issues life so graced, not by age to be defaced, budding as the year in sooth, every spring another youth. And what Thor can add beside, crown this bride and this bride.
You have sealed a joy close to my soul, Euphrania. Now I may call thee mine.
I now but exchange one good friend for another.
These gallants breeze to grace a poor invention. By joining with me in some slight device, I'll venture on a strain my young days have studied for delight.
In thankful weariness, I offer my attendance. No endeavour of mine will fail to show itself.
We all wait on thy direction, Orgilus.
Oh, my good lord, your favours flow toward a too unworthy worm, but as you please, I am what you'll shape me.
A fast friend.
Thank thee, son, for this acknowledgement. It is a sight of gladness.
But my duty.
a winding sheet, a fold of lead, and someone trod on corner of the earth. Not to detain your expectation, princess. I have a humble suit. Speak.
I enjoy it.
Safe then, to be my executrix, and take that trouble on you to disperse such legacies as I bequeath impartially. I have not much to give, the pains are easy. I may reward you for your piety and thank you when I am dead. For sure, I must not live! Such as abuse, not wedlock for freedom of desires. Recover chiefly the pledges of chaste beds for ties of love rather than raging in their blood. And next, to marry maids, such as prefer the number of runnable issues in their virtues before the flesh who delights in marriage. May those be ever young. Second, do you mean to part with? It is my fame. I trust by scandal yet untouched. This I bequeath to memory and time's old daughter truth. If ever my unhappy name by mention when I'm fallen to dust, may it deserve beseeming charity without dishonor. How handsomely thou hast placed the harmless thought of me imagination! Speak loud, stranger like thy will. This jewel, madam, is dearly precious to me. You must use the best of your discretion to employ it as intended.
Do not doubt me.
It is longer gone since I first lost my heart. Longer I have lived without it, else for certain I should have given that too. And instead of it, the great Calantha, Sparta's heir, my service vowed and my affections vowed, I do bequeath. Holiest rites of love, mine own brother, Iphicles.
What says thou?
Impute not, heaven blessed lady, how like the prayers of a devoted supplicant can endow it. Look on him, princess, with an eye of pity, how like the ghost of what he late appears and moves before you.
Shall I answer here, or lend my aid too graciously?
First, his heart shall fall in cinders. And here he will dare, poor man, to open out on these divine looks, with low bent thoughts accusing such presumption. As for words, it dares not utter any but of service. Yet this lost creature loves ye. Be a princess in sweetness as in blood, and give him his doom, or raise him up to comfort.
What new change appears in my behavior, that doth there accept my displeasure?
I must leave the world to revel in Elysium. And it is just to wish my brother some advantage here. Yet by my best hopes, Iphicles is ignorant of this pursuit. But if you please to kill him, lend him one angry look or one harsh word, and you shall soon conclude how strong a power your absolute authority hangs over his life and end.
You have forgot, Pentheus, how I still have a mother.
But remember, I am a sister. But to me this brother hath been,
unkind, and most unkind, ethically wronged lady. My reckonings are made even. Death or fate can now nor strike too soon, nor force too late.
Too stubborn credit. I am not, but you doubt me.
Nephew, be then as I would wish. All is not right, but heaven confirm your resolution for dependence on worthy ends, which may advance your quiet.
I did the noble orders much injury, but greed Pentheum more. I now repent it. Now and if now is now too late. So providence falling in sad issue like after willed, like bankrupt death stand tallies without all possibility of payment. Sure, he's an honest, a very honest gentleman, a man of single meaning.
I believe it. Yet, nephew, it is the tongue informs our ears. Our eyes can never pierce into the thoughts, for they are lodged you inward. But I question your truth and orderless. The princess.
The princess?
With her, the Prince of Argos.
Good, fair one. Grace my hopes by the instance of delivery, to the allowance of your favour, this little spark.
A toy!
Of feasts on toys, for Cupid is a child. But save this bounty, cannot be denied.
You shall not buy, you sweet cousin, at a price where I can't keep. So cheap, then let him take it to dare stoop for it, and give our next meeting to a mistress. You'll thank him for it, perhaps.
The ring, sir, was the princess's. I could have took it up.
Learned manners privy. To the blessed owner, upon my knees.
You are saucy.
This is pretty. I am belike a mistress. Oh, wondrous pretty. Keep his fortune, since he found it, he's worthy on it. On, cousin!
My lord, you are too forward.
Lucky aunt! Some such day who took above the contempt form of our care and never thought of plenty, and after full repast can lay them down to sleep, and they sleep on it, in which silence their very dreams present them choice of pleasures. Pleasures. Observe me, aunt, of rare object. Here heaps in gold, increments of honours, then change of garments, then the vote of the people, and in varieties and beauties, courting philastery to the night, then exchanging dalliance. Give me felicity, which may partake as a real, visible, material happiness. And then too, when I stagnate, comfort that can cherish life. I swore it, aunt, I swore it for the king from her own hand.
The princess threw it to you.
True what she said? Well, I remember what, and it cost the prince of Bennett.
Yes, and part of an anger at your taking on it.
Or perfidy to plead with a powerful language. I want to be in gravity for thy merit, but will do.
What is it you say?
In anger, let him part! For could his breath like whirlwinds toss such vile slaves, as take the dust of the prince into a vapour. It dares not stay a hair of mine, it dare not. I dread up by the roots birth. Be anything Calanthus smiles on, would be a blessing of us. Sacred in the pet prince of Argos could wish to equal in worth or title.
Contain yourself, my lord. Zion aiming to embrace you, no bosom but a cloud, and begets centaurs. It is a useful moral. Ambition hides in clouds of mere opinion, proves but in bare prodigy.
I thank ye. Yet if your license, I should seem uncharitable to a gentle fate. If Roush and a deity for soul set of peace, I would be feeble not to digest it.
He deserves small trust who is not privy counsellor to himself.
Your excellent mistakes his temper for. Ithocles and fashion of his mind, the soft, beautiful, gentle, the clear mirror of absolute perfection.
Was it your modesty termed any of the prince's servants? Spaniel, your ne'er sure taught you other language.
Language?
A gallant man at arms is here. A doctor in feats of chivalry. Blunt and rough spoken. Vouchsafing the foosting of civility. his less rash spirit style good manners.
Manners no more, illustrious sir. It is much as it please.
You might have understood who I am.
Yes, I did, Alice. The presence called me a front. Your cousin to the princess.
To the queen, too. A certain instrument that lends importance to you, colossic greatness. To that queen, too, you might have added.
There's more beauty in divinity than there is in majesty.
Oh, fie, fie!
This arduous pride turns heretic in loyalty, sirrah. Low mushrooms never rival Caesar's.
Come back! What a pitiful dull finger I can contain and shoulder at! Come back! Let her come back at once! An accurate score will sound a mushroom! Paint the courage like Harold's courage to Jill Silver! And make bait a mother lion!
Cousin, cousin, thy tongue is not thy friend.
In point of honour, discretion knows no bounds. It is all about a little ring.
I ring the princess from away, and I took up, and make you fear it to me! No, because he grind a hoof to powder, and I threw away my heart and it still one dust on it! All yours! I'm extremely wrong!
A lady's favour is not to be slighted.
Slighted!
Quiet these vain unruly passions, which will render into a madness.
Griefs will have their vent.
Welcome. Now comes the season, Reverend Man, to pour the balsam of a supplying patience into the festering wounds of Ilspent Fury.
What makes you here? Hurt yet but mortal, but shortly. Prove deadly to the Queen, Coatlon. See in safety and deliver this seal of counsel. Bid her with a constancy pursue of the gods. Oh, Sparta. Oh, Lacedaemon. Double named, but one in fate. When kingdoms reel, mark well my saw, their heads must needs be giddy. Tell the Queen. She no more must inquire after my aged head. Apollo wills it so. I'm for Delphos.
Not without some conference with our great mistress?
Never more to see her. The greater monarch commands me. Ithacles!
When youth is ripe, and age from time doth part, the lifeless trunk shall wed the broken heart.
What's this if understood?
List. Ordless. Remember what I told thee long before. These tears shall be my witness.
Alas, good man.
Craft and courtesy are wild confer. Revenge proves its own execution.
Dark sentences for Apollo's feasts. Thy own more equals.
My hour is come. Cheer up the Queen. Farewell to all.
Oh, Sparta! Oh, Lacedaemon!
If prophetic fire have warmed this old man's bosom, we might construe his words to fatal sense.
Leave the powers above us to their decrees. My fervent eyes within me. To vile fears prevents no great effect. Divine Calantha!
Don't think all these books are written, yet talk the weeping.
The crop of cards your wild confer, revenge proves its own executioner.
You've called it again? For what? It is dotage of a withered brain. Pentheus forbade me her presence. May I see her? Gaze my fill. Why see her then? I may when, if I faint to speak. I must be silent.
Pray use your recreations. All the service I will expect is quietness amongst you. Take liberty at home, abroad, at all times. And in your charities appease the gods, whom I with my distractions have offended.
For
Four blessings on my heart.
Here's a rare change. My lord, to cure the itch is surely gelded. The cuckold and his thief have cast his horns.
We take you to your several occasions, and wherein I have heretofore been faulty, yet your constructions mildly pass it over. Henceforth I'll study reformation. More I have not for employment.
Oh, sweet man, thou art the very unicorn of honesty.
The garland of goodwill. Old lady, hold up thy reverend snout and trot behind me softly as it becomes a moil of ancient carriage.
Only capable of sense enjoy the benefit of food and ease of thankfulness. Such silly creatures that are grudging, not against the fortune nature hath bestowed. But men, endowed with reason and the use of reason, can distinguish from the chaff of abject scarcity, the quintessence, soul, elixir of the earth's abundance, the treasures of the sea, the air, nay, heaven. And repining at these glories are very beasts and beasts. And of these beasts, the worst am I. I, who was made a monarch of what a heart could wish for, a chaste wife, endeavored what in me lay to pull down that temple built for adoration only, and leavened from the dust of cause and scandal. But to redeem a sacrilege so impious, humility shall pour. Before the deities, I have incessed the largest of more patience than the displeased altars can require. No tempest of commotion shall disquiet the calms of my composure.
I have found thee, thou patron of more horrors than the bulk of manhood, whom to bow with rivers of iron can ground within thy breast. Pentheus, Basinus, cursed by thy jealousies, more thy dosage is left a prey to words.
Your trials for addition to my penance. I am resolved.
Play not with misery's past cure. Some angry minister had deposed the empress of her soul, her reason from its most proper throne. What's the miracle warn you? I have seen her yet live!
You may delude my senses, not my judgment. It is anchored in a firm resolution. Dalliance of mirth or wit can ne'er unfix it. Practice yet further.
May thy death of love to her damn all thy comforts to a lasting fast from every joy of life. Thou barren rock, by thee we are split in care of Homer!
Sister, Rocco, your brother, your Iphicles speaks to you. Why do you weep? See it turn off from me. Here is a caring silence. My bastard is a lamentable object.
Man doth see! Sports of all gamesome! Am I yet in merriment? Why does not laugh?
Divine and best of ladies, please forget my outrage. Mercy ever can but lodge under a roof so excellent. I have outcast that frenzy of which once appeared in posture and juggled to sheep my sleeps of rest.
Was I in earnest?
Sure, if we were all sirens, we should sing pitifully. And if it were a comely music, we're in one part sung it as now. It hurts his sighs when he has lost his mate. But some say he must be dead first. There's a fond deceit to pass away in a dream. Indeed, I have slept with mine eyes in a great while. No falsehood equals a broken faith. It's not a hair that sticks on my head. Like a leaden plummet, it sinks me to the grave. I must creep thither. The journey is not long.
But thou Pentheus hast many years. I hope to number yet. Ears, thou can't travel this way.
Let the sun first be wrapped up in an everlasting darkness before the light of nature, chiefly formed for the whole world's delight, feel an eclipse so universal.
Wisdom, look ye, begins to reign! Art thou mad too, antiquity?
Since I was first a wife, I may have been mother to many pretty prattling babies. They would have smiled when I smiled. And for sure, I should have cried when they cried. Truly, brother, my father would have picked me out a husband. And then my little ones would have been no bastards. But it is too late for me to marry now. I am past childbearing. It is not my fault.
Fall on me if there be a burning Etna and bury me in flames. Sweats as hot as sulfur boil through my pores. Affliction had in store no torture like to this.
Behold a patient! Lay by her wine in great dissimulation. Do something worth the chronicle. Show justice upon the author of this mischief. Dig out thy jealousies that hast this roll of verse at thine own poignard. Every hunting rouch can roar as I does!
Or just the best!
Serve him not! It is a talking motion provided for my torment. And what a fool am I to bandy passion. Here, I'll speak a word. I will look on and burst!
I loved you once.
Thou still, wronged creature. In the spite of malice for it, I love thee ever.
Spare your hand. Believe me, I'll not hurt it.
My heart too?
I'll kiss it. Oh, it is a fine soft palm. Hearken, thine ear, like whom do I look, privy? Nay, no whispering. Goodness, we have been happy. Too much happiness will make folk proud, they say. But that's he. And yet he paid for it home. Alas, his heart is crept into the cabinet of the princess. We shall have points and bride laces. Remember when we last gathered roses in the garden? I found my wits, but truly, you lost yours.
Poor soul. Oh, idly her fancies guide her tongue.
Keep in vexation, break not into clamour.
She has tutored me. Some powerful inspiration checks my laziness. Now let me kiss your hand, grieved beauty.
Kiss it. Alack, his lips be wondrous cold. Dear soul has lost his colour. Have ye seen a straying heart? All crannies, every drop of blood is turned to our amethyst, which my bachelor is hanging in their ears.
Peace, usher into Elysium! If this be madness, madness is an oracle!
Grani's wed slept, my sister. Her ravings are so wild.
Sir, not these 10 days. We watch by her continually. Besides, you cannot any way put her to eat.
Oh, misery of miseries.
Take comfort. You may live well and die a good old man. Thy yea and nay and oath not to be broken if you had joined our hands once in the temple. For it was since my father died. For had he lived, he would have done it. I must have called you father. Oh, my rapt honour. Ruined by those tyrants. A cruel brother and a desperate dotage. To all memory. Pentheus. Poor Pentheus' name is strumpeted. Since her blood was forfeited. And the seasons of noble shame. Her blood, it is just. We henceforth never hide him of this haste of sustenance. Stop. That's not fullness whose flourish you have, even faith and modesty. Forgive me. Oh, hey!
Be not so willful, sweet niece, to wake thine own destruction.
Nature called her daughter monster. What? Not eat? If you see the only ordinary means that you obtain for life, be not thy sister. Murderous to thyself. Hearest thou this, Bassinus?
Woe! I am busy, for I have thought
all shall be well anon. It's a tumbling in my head. There's a mastery in art to fatten up and keep smooth the outside. Yes, and to comfort up the vital spirits without the help of food, fumes or perfumes, perfumes or fumes. Let her alone! I'll search out the trick on it.
Lead me gently. Heaven's reward ye. Reeves are sure friends. They leave about control. No cure. No comfort for a leper's soul.
I grant ye, and shall put into practice instantly what ye shall still admire. It is wonderful. It is super singular. And yet when it is done, it is done. Ye all shall thank me!
Sight is full of terror.
Of my soul lies such an infinite crock of Macedonians, which I have not sense enough to feel it. See, and the angry thing returns again, and we shall welcome him with thunder. For we are haunted, and must use exorcism to conjure up the spirit of malevolence.
Mildly, nephew.
Not set to judge your late disorder. Admitting the annulment to the roughness of soldiers, your years and fortunes, so lately prosperous, hath not yet shook off the custom of the war in hours of leisure. Nor shall you need excuse, since you are to render account to that fair excellence, the princess, who in her private gallery expects it from your mouth alone. I'm a messenger but to her pleasure.
Excellent natures, reprint my services still, unconquered without combat or dispute. I honor ye.
The queen is on a sudden indisposed. Positions are called for, if it were fit. You should be near her.
Sir, I kiss your hands.
I perceive Calantha's bosom is warmed with other fires, as soot can take strength from any fuel of the love I might address to her. Young Ithacles, whatever I mistake, is Lord Ascendant, her devotions. One to speak him truly in every disposition, nobly fashioned.
How can your highness brook to be so rivaled, considering the inequality of the persons?
I can, Crotalon, for affections ended by tyranny or rigor of compulsion. Tempest threatened trees are firmly rooted and then a spring to the time they grow. Take, for instance, life of Pentheia and sometimes the orgies.
How does your grace determine?
To be jealous of the public of what crowded they are further. Though they do not know, they shall find out.
We will be private. Health unto your majesty. What? Technicus is gone?
He is to Delphos, unto your royal hands, presents this box.
Unseal it. Good Crotalon. Therein lie the secret of the oracle. Out with it. Apollo live our patron. Read, Crotalon.
Plot in which the vine takes root begins to dry from head to foot. The stalk soon withering, want of sap, doth cause to quail the budding grape. But from the neighboring elm a juice shall drop and feed the plot anew.
That is the oracle. What exposition makes the philosopher?
This brief one only. The plot of Sparta, the dried vine, the queen, the quailing grape-haired daughter. But the thing of most importance, not to be revealed, is a near prince. The elm, the rest concealed. Technically.
Enough. Although the opening of this riddle be but itself a riddle, yet we construe how near our labouring age draws to a rest. But must Calantha quail too? That young grape untimely budded, I could mourn for her. Her tenderness hath yet deserved no rigour so to be crossed by fate. May it prove so, for weal of this dear nation. Where is Iphicles? Croton, when this withered vine of my frail carcass and the funeral pile is fired into ashes, let that young man be hedged about still with your cares and loves. Much I owe to his worth, much to his service. Let such as wait come in now. All attend here. Dear lady, queen, mother!
My royal mistress!
Cleave not my heart, sweet twins of my life's solace. With your forejudging fears, there is no physic so cunningly restorative to cherish the fall of age. Oh, call back youth and vigour. As your consent and duty, I will shake off this languishing disease of time to quicken fresh pleasures in these drooping hours of sadness. Is fair Euphrania married yet to Prophilus?
This morning, gracious lady.
This very morning, which was your highness's leave, you may observe, too. Our sister looks, methinks, mirthful and sprightly. Isabel chased the fancy corollary, expound the riddle of her gain in losing the trifle maids know only that they know not. Pish! Prithee blush not! Tell us change of fashion in the garment, loose the straight, and so the modest maid is made a wife. Shrewd business, is it not, sister?
You are pleasant.
We thank thee, Orgilus. This mirth becomes thee. But wherefore sits the court in such silence? A wedding without revels is not seemly.
You're late in this vision, man. Forbid it.
Be it thy charge, Calantha, to set forward the bridal sport to which I will be present. If not, at least consenting. Mine own Iphicles, I have done little for thee yet.
You've built me to the full height I stand in.
Now or never. May propose a suit.
Demand and have it.
Pray, man, give me this young man, and no further account than yours, and he deserves and all things before worth mine. I will esteem him according to his merit.
Still thou art my daughter, still grossed upon my heart. Give me thine hand, Calantha, take thine own. In noble actions thou wilt find him firm and absolute. Iphicles, I would not have parted with thee to any but to a mistress who is all of what I am.
A change, great queen, most wished for, because the same.
Thou art mine. Have I now kept my word?
Divinely.
Which fortunes guard the favour of Princess Rockthee? Brave man in ever crowd of plenty. You are minion of the time, be thankful for it.
O hear the swing of destiny of pirates. The youth is up on tiptoe, yet may stumble.
On to your recreations. Now, convey me unto my bedchamber. None on her forehead wear a distempered look.
God preserve ye!
The gods preserve ye!
Oh, Felicity.
Shall I be bold, my lord?
Thou art not Orgilus. Call me thine own, for Prophilus must henceforth be all thy sister's friendship. Thou not in marriage, yet doth it less command than a single freedom can dispose it.
Most right, my most good lord, my most great lord, my gracious princely lord, I might add royal.
Royal? A subject royal?
Why not pray, sir? The sovereignty of kingdoms is in their noted stoop to desert, not birth. There's as much merit and clearness of affection as in a puddle of generation. You have conquered love, even in the loveliest. If I greatly err not, the son of Venus hath bequeathed his quiver to Iphicles, his manage by whose arrows Calantha's breast is opened.
Can't be possible.
I myself was a piece of suitor once, forward and preferment too. So forward that, speaking truth, I may without offence, sir, presume to whisper them my hopes and... Hark ye! My certainty of marriage to the shore with as firm footing as any's by your leave in this very instant, but...
It is granted. I've no eager privacy between us. Read over my bosom and partake his secret. The princess is contracted mine.
Still, why not? I applaud her wisdom. Where your kingdom stands seated in your will, secure and settled, I dare pronounce you be a just monarch. Greece must admire and tremble.
Then the sweetness of its own paradise to comfort. Audience, it is a banquet of the gods.
The glory of numerous children, potencies of nobles, hearts bathed to tread on.
With a friendship so dear, so fast as fine.
I am unfitting for office, but for service.
We distinguish our fortunes and bearing a title. Partners and all else except the bed.
Ha! The bed! Defended Jove's own jealousy till lastly we slip down on the common earth together. And there our beds are equal, save some monument to show this the queen and this the subject, and... Soft, sad music. List, what sad sounds are these? Extremely sad ones.
Sure. From Hephaestus' lodgings.
Hark, a voice too!
Tread softly, there is mystery and mourning.
Tis done. That in her right hand.
Good.
Soft peace and richness brew.
How fares the lady?
Dead, stark.
Tell us how she parted from life.
She called for music, and begged some gentle voice to tune her farewell to life's griefs. I touched the lute, and wept the funeral song which scarce was pretended, but her last breath sealed up this hollow sound. Oh, cruel Iphicles and injured Orgyllus. So died.
So died.
Ah! You are the messenger of death. Go from us! Here's woe enough to call without a prompter. Away! And hark ye! Till ye see us next, no syllable that she is dead! Away! And keep a smooth brow. My lord.
My only sister. The mother has not left me.
Take that chair. I'll sit me here in this. Between us sits the objects of our sorrows. Some of you tears will part among us. I perhaps can mix one of them with a story to prepare them. There! There! Sit there, my lord!
Yes, I should praise. What means this treachery?
Court! You are court, young master! 'Tis thy throne of coronation, thou fool of greatness! Survey a beauty, withered by the flames of an insulting patron, her brother.
Thou meant to kill me so basely!
I foreknew the last act of her life, and trained thee hither to sacrifice a tyrant to a turtle. You dreamt of kingdoms, did ye? How to bosom the delicacies of a youngling princess. How this nod to make that subtle courtier. How this frown to make this noble tremble. And so forth. While Pentheus groans and tortures, her miseries, agonies, afflictions never touched upon your thoughts. As for my injuries, alas, they were beneath your royal pity. But yet lived!
Strike her! A courteous king as I have rent should give a welcome. But pray me, fail not. The wound grows up tender with double force and surge deeply. Thou look at thy swine, beck your passion. As those beneath the faders of thy glory. I stay to your resolution, armed by confidence. To curse thee upon it. Live and I with equal to our equal fortunes by the hands of a duel. It's too mighty for slave intending murder. On with the execution!
By Apollo, thou talks of goodly language. Require to thou report thee to thy mistress richly. Some few short minutes to term and shall quickly follow thy wrathful ghost. Then, if we tug for mastery, Pentheus safe and I shall lend new courage. Lend thy hand. Be helpful in thy lost mortality. Thus I free it! gentle, even in blood, to linger pain, which I strive to cure, were to be cruel.
Nimble in vengeance, I forgive thee. Follow safety and best success, all may it prosper. Pamphia, by thy side, thy brother bleeds. The earnest of his wrongs to thy false faith. Fought a delicious banquet of beauty, youth, and love together perish in their last breath, which, on a sacred altar of a long looked for peace, now moves to heaven.
Farewell, fair spring of manhood. Henceforth, welcome expectation of a noble sufferant. I'll lock the body safe to what must follow, should we approve. Sweet twins, shine stars forever. They build their hopes, whose life is shame. No monument lasts, but a happy name.
Sure yet.
Honor, attend thy counsels ever!
I beseech thee, let me go from thee quietly. I will not aught to do with thee, of all men. The doubles of a hair. We're in a mourning salute from a splay-footed witch. To drop 3 drops of blood that knows just, and no more. The croaking of ravens or screeching of owls are no so boding mischief as crossing my private meditation. Show me, prithee, if I cannot love thee heartily, I love thee as well as I can.
Noble Bartolus, mistake me not.
Phew! Then we are troubled. Thou wert ordained my plague. Heaven, make me thankful and give me patience to heaven. I beseech thee.
Accept the League of Amity. Henceforth, I vow by my best genius in a syllable never to speak vexation. I will study service and friendship with the zealous sorrow of my past incivility towards you.
Hey, day! Good words! Good words! I must believe them and be a coxcomb for my labor.
Use not so hard a language! Your misdoubt is causeless. For instance, if you promised upon our constancy of patience, such a patience as chronicle or history never mentioned, but shall stand a wonder and a theme for imitation, the first, the index pointing to the second, I will acquaint you with an unmatched secret, to whose knowledge your grief shall set a period.
Thou canst not, Orgilus. 'Tis in the power of the gods only. Yet for satisfaction, because I notice an earnest in thine utterance, unforced and naturally free. Be resolute. The virgin bays shall not withstand a lightning with a more careless danger than the constancy of thy full relation. Could thou find distraction in a senseless marble statue, thou should find me a rock! now expect to hear some truth of unheard moment?
To your patience, you must add privacy. As strong in silence as mysteries locked up in Jove's own bosom.
A skull hid in the earth of treble age shall soon prate.
Lastly, such direction as severity is, deserves to lead your judgments and your wisdom. You ought to yield obedience.
With assurance of will and thankfulness.
With manly courage, please then to follow me.
Wherever. I fear not.
Whispered some new device to which these rebels should be but usher. Wherein I conceive Lord Iphicles and himself are actors.
A fair excuse for absence, as the fastness to light in the shores. On to the dance!
Thank you.
purity of blood enamel, the beauty of your white.
We all look cheerfully. And cousin, does me think to rare children in any who prefer our lawful pleasures before their own sour censure to interrupt the custom of the ceremony bluntly?
None dares, lady.
Yes, yes, some hollow voice delivered to me how that the queen was dead.
The queen is dead. That fatal news was mine. For in mine arms she breathed her last, and with her crown, bequeathed thee your mother's wedding ring, which I hear tender. Most strange.
Long live Calantha, Sparta's sovereign queen.
Long live the queen!
What whisper, Basnus?
That my Pentheon, miserable soul, will starve to death.
She's happy. She hath finished a long and painful progress. A third member pierced man in willing ears.
That Ithacles is murdered, rather butchered, and not bravery of an undaunted spirit conquering terror proclaimed his last act triumph over ruin.
How? Murdered? By whose hand?
By mine. This weapon was instrument to my revenge. The reasons are just and known. Quit him of these and never lived greater gentleman. Of hope, ablement to steer a kingdom.
You have done it.
How it was done, let him report. The forfeit of whose allegiance to our laws doth covet rigor of justice. Yet that done it is. Mine eyes have been an evidence of credit too sure to be convinced. Crotalon, rent not thine arteries with hearing the best circumstances of these calamities. Continue, man, still. Make me the pattern of digesting evils who can outlive my mighty ones. Not shrinking under such pressures would sink a soul into what's most of death, the worst of horrors. I have sealed a covenant with sadness, entered into bonds without condition, to stand these tempests calmly. Mark me, nobles! I do not shed a tear! Not for Pentheus! Excellent misery!
We begin our reign with the first act of justice. Thy confession, unhappy Orgilus, dooms thee sentence. But yet thy mother and thy sister's presence shall be excused. Give Crotalon a blessing to thy son. Euphrania, take a farewell and both be gone!
My brother, confirm thee noble sorrow and worthy resolution. Don't my tears beat my crystals.
Oh, goodness, dwell amongst ye. Enjoy, my sister Propolis. My vengeance saves never thy prejudice.
Black and elates of the saints in blood, that no half reports him. His fortunes and life by thee are both at once snatched from him. Mention. Make thy choice of what thou likes thee best. There's all our bounty. But to excuse delays, dear cousin, let me treat you and all his lords to execution instant before you part.
Your will command us.
One suit, just queen, my last. Vouchsafe your clemency that by no common hand I be divided from this humble frailty.
To the wisdoms who are to be spectators of thine end, I make the reference! son had died. Of necessity, they must have paid the debt due to nature one time or other. You suspect my lord. You will suddenly prepare a coronation.
Tragedy should never touch on her female pity.
She has a masculine spirit. And wherefore should I pule like a girl and put finger in the eye? Let's be all toughness, without distinction betwixt sex and sex.
Now, Argilus, thy choice?
To bleed to death!
The executioner?
Myself, no surgeon. I am well skilled in letting blood. Bind fast these arms, so that the conduits made from their pipes convey a full stream. Here's a skillful instrument. Only I am begging to some charity to speed me the execution. By lightning the other prick to the other arm, when this is bubbling life out. Nature have inclined the eager bloodshed, a coward's guilt, and a coward's quaking, would have betrayed fame to a noble flight, a vagabond pursuit, and dreadful safety. But look upon my steadiness, and scorn not the sickness of my fortune, which, since Basilus was husband to Pentheia, had lain bedridden. We trifle times and words. Thus I show a cunning in opening a vein, too full, too lively. No!
Desperate courage, honorable infamy. I tremble at the sight, but I will lose.
It sparkles like a lusty wine new broached. The vessel must be sound from which it issues. Grasp hard this stick!
Ah!
Halby is nimble. Oh, prithee, look not pale. Habachi! Stretch out thine arm with vigor and unshook virtue!
Ah!
Good! Oh, I envy not a rival fitted to conquer in such extremities. This pastime appears majestical. Some high-tuned poem hereafter shall give posterity to the writer's glory and the subject's triumph. How dost, man? Droop not yet.
I feel no palsies. On a pair royal to my weight and death, on his lyman as my sovereign, on my mistress as if no devoted servant, on Ithocles. As if no brave, yet no unworthy enemy. Ah! Nor did I use an engine to entrap his life out of a slavish fear to combat you, strength and cunning. But for that I dare not engage the goodness of a cause on fortune, by which his name I dwell faced my vengeance. O Technicus, inspired by Phoebus' fire, I call to mind thy augury, was perfect. Revenge proves its own executioner. When feeble men is bending to his mother, and first the worst framed on, thus he totters. Ah!
Ah! Life's fountain has dried up.
So falls my standard in being a creature. A mist hangs over my eyes. The sun's bright splendor is clouded in an everlasting shadow. Welcome, thou ice that sits upon my heart. No heat can ever thaw thee.
Hands of time. The funeral urn shall be my charge. Remove the bloodless body. The coronation must require attendance. For that past, my few days can be but one morn.
know the fortunes of princes and masks and stone composition. A woman has enough to govern wisely. Her own demeanours, passions and divisions. A nation warlike and Lord Prasso policy cannot brook a feminist authority. We therefore command your counsel, how you may advise us in choosing of a better husband whose abilities can better guide his kingdom.
Royal lady, your law is in your will.
We have seen tokens of constancy too lately to mistrust it. Yet, if your highness settle on a choice by your own judgment, both allowed and like Darth, Sparta may grow in power and proceed to an increasing height. Hold you the same mind?
Alas, great mistress, reason is so clouded with the thick darkness of my infinite woes that I forecast no hopes, dangers, nor safety. Give me some corner of the world where I may wear out the remnant of the minutes I must number, where I may hear no sounds but the sad complaints of virgins who have lost contracting partners, of friends divided by churlish opposition, of husbands howling their wives ravished by some untimely fate, of fathers weeping over their children's slaughtered carcasses, of daughters groaning over their father's hearses. And I can dwell there, and with them make consort as musical as theirs. What else can thou look for from an old, doting, foolish, peevish man with the craziness of age?
Here's the Vargas.
Madame?
Were I presently to choose you for my lord, I'll open freely what article I would propose to treat on before our marriage.
Name them, virtuous lady.
I would presume you would retain the royalty of Sparta in her own bounds. Then in Argos, might Crotalon be viceroy. In Messene, might Granny's first way. Ambassadors, be Sparta's marshal. The multitudes of high employments could not set a peace to proud the Greeks. This gentlewoman, Grausus, with a worthy pension, should wait upon your person in your chamber.
This is a testament? It sounds not like conditions on a marriage.
All this should be performed.
Lastly, for Prophilus, she should be cousin. Solemnly invested in all those honours, titles, and affirmations which your dear friends and my neglected husband for a short time enjoyed.
I am unworthy to live in your remembrance.
Excellent lady.
Madame, what means that word, neglected husband?
Forgive me. Now I turn to thee. Thou shattered my contact with the Lord. Bear witness, all. I put my mother's wedding ring upon his finger. It was my mother's last request. To sign you marry him, his wife I am. Death shall not separate us. Oh, my lords, I but deceived your eyes with empty gestures. But when one new streak came home on another, of death and death and death to light that forward.
Lips. My last.
command the voices which wait at the altar. Now to sing the song I fit up my end.
Sirs, the song.
Indeed. O royal maid, would thou have missed this part? It was a brave one. I must weep to see her smile in death.
Wise Tacitus, thus said he, when youth is ripe and age from time doth part, the lifeless trunk shall wed the broken heart. Is here fulfilled?
I am your king.
Long live Nearchus, king of Sparta!
Long live Nearchus, king of Sparta!